Recorded Books presents A Girl's Guide to Love and Magic by Debbie Rigaud. Narrated by Debbie Rigaud. In heartfelt memory of my dynamic, exuberant dad, Willy Rigaud. Prologue. 6 years ago. What's magical to most? Is familiar to me. So when I found myself plunged into dark nothingness, except for brilliant points of light all around, I wasn't weirded out. The cosmos was zipping by on either side of me. The only thing I couldn't figure out was if I was standing still or racing through the stars. I sensed an energy buzzing at my core. It seemed like this place, which felt dreamlike, though it wasn't exactly a dream, had summoned me. I was at home. Until I wasn't. I woke to soft tapping sounds. My eyes fluttered open, but I lay still, taking a moment to make sense of it all. To catch up. Where was I? Who was I? The pulsating sensation of cosmic travel drained from me, just as real-world information seeped in. I was Cicely Destin, age 9. I was in my bedroom, in Flatbush, Brooklyn. Earth. The tapping sounds, which I could now clearly make out as rhythmic clapping, drew me out of bed to investigate. Each step across my small room was amplified by the creak of the floorboards and the swish of my Scooby-Doo print pajamas. I winced at the racket I was making, wondering if my aunt Tati Mimos was still here babysitting me. My parents and Grandma Rose had gone on their annual Feast of St. Anne pilgrimage to honor the Catholic saint at some faraway cathedral. I was supposed to be asleep and didn't want to be caught out of bed, but my curiosity cared nothing for consequences. I reached my door, cracked it open, and peeked down the hall to the living room. That's when I observed something I never had seen before, a magic that was truly magical to me. Tati Mimos stood above a dancing fire that burned in a metal basin. One sinewy arm raised and her beautiful face glowering. The licking blue flames had nothing on the fire behind my aunt's eyes. She hadn't even looked this intense when she dominated the soul train line at our last neighborhood block party. My aunt was mesmerizing on a regular day when she'd hold court in our spice-scented kitchen, laughing and trash-talking to a rapt audience of my mom and Grandma Rose, while I giddily wobbled around in her high-heeled shoes. But Tati Mimos in dramatic flame lighting? I could not shut my door on this pageantry any easier than I could stuff streamers back into a confetti popper. How could a person not want to see more? Much less a 9-year-old, thick in her mystery and fantasy fandom phase, who imagined herself to be part firecracker Mimos? The other half of me was all mom, rigid and disciplined. Still, I heeded the internal call nudging me forth farther down the hall into the living room. I stopped, hidden from view. Two other women stood beside my aunt, steadily clap-clapping, all three of them wearing ceremonial white dresses. The coffee table had been cleared to make room for a wooden stool that held the basin. It was like a stage set for theater, and Tati Mimos was playing the lead role. Her nimble fingers moved with flair as she tied her red satin scarf around her head and spoke in that familiar, rumbling voice she used every time she told me not to forget that I came from a line of powerful women. We invoke the power of the ancestors. We call upon my family Lua, Ogun the warrior, to bar all evildoers from our presence. My aunt's shoulders were squared up, her fists balled, and her face stern. Were hers not the eyes of someone I love so dearly, I would be fearful of the intensity flashing from them. It looks like my aunt, but it doesn't. Tati Mimos began to dance like she was sparring with a shadow partner. She struck warrior poses while the clappers' chants rang out in Haitian Creole, the catchy melody sung flatly like a playground song. And then my aunt stopped abruptly, swiped her hand in the fiery basin, and grabbed a handful of flames. I smacked my palm over my mouth in shock. Wouldn't she burn? I couldn't say for sure. Everything about the ceremony was new to me. Yes, the tune the women were chanting was similar to the folkloric music my dad listened to when my mom wasn't home. And there on the mantelpiece, weren't those the prayer candles Grandma Rose kept lit on whatever feast day for whatever patron saint she told all her secrets to? But Tati Mimo's actually touching fire and dancing like a warrior? I'd never seen that. This right here was Vodou. I was pretty sure of that. My family was Haitian. A chipmunk cheek boy at school had once said that Haitians and Vodou went hand in hand. He later tried to say he was joking, but that's just because he got caught by the teacher. You can tell what you're expected to feel about Vodou by the way folks handle the word. Vodou. Voodoo. Voodoo. Sometimes the word was carted around like a personal item other people played keep away with. They'd give you taunting glimpses of it, pretend to hand it back, and then yank it away to make a spectacle of you. Eventually, to avoid the humiliation, you'd stop trying to snatch it. You'd even avoid eyeing it, lest anyone remember it originally belonged to you. But not if you were Mimo's. She'd post a busted selfie on her socials before she'd let anyone shame her about Vodou. What's there to hide about an age-old spiritual belief system that's about guiding and protecting its practitioners? I heard her say to my mom once. For my mom and everyone else in my family, the word Vodou was handled like a ticking bomb, carefully and with a whisper of a touch so as not to trip its wires. No one seemed to want the type of attention an explosion of that word would bring. But there was nothing whispery about the way Tati Mimos was wielding Vodou tonight. I took a step deeper into the living room, eager to see more. When a gruff voice rasped what sounded like, "You!" I jumped like double Dutch ropes were slapping the floor beneath my feet. Tati Mimos waved me over. For a moment, I considered hiding behind the wall in the hopes that my aunt would mistake what she'd seen. Being out of bed this late was not allowed. My mom liked to say, "You go looking for trouble, you go and find it." If she and my dad found out about this, they would take away my tablet for the weekend, and Grandma Rose would be unbearable in her deep disappointment. But I was too drawn in to leave now. Without realizing when or how I had come to stand before Tati Mimos, there I was. And there she was, peering down on me expectantly and mumbling words I could not make out. "Can you repeat that, Tati?" I timidly asked. "I can't understand." My aunt issued another throaty, unintelligible communication, gesturing in the same forceful manner that she'd warrior danced earlier. Again, I did not comprehend a single word. My aunt seemed so unlike herself that I wondered if Vodou's guidance and protection could be offered by an actual spirit who took temporary control of a person's body. That whole part? I guess that was what put my mom and other family members off Vodou. Tati Mimos swiped a hand into the basin again. I flinched, startled by an up-close view of the blue flames she was cupping. She then smoothed the fire between her palms, rubbing briskly until I thought she'd start another fire. A small part of me had already bolted from the room, torn down the hall, and found a hiding place under my bed. But all the rest of me didn't budge, and watched in awe as Tati Mimos, in a not-quite-herself way, laid a fire-washed hand atop the soft twists cascading from my head. I braced for a burning sensation, but instead felt a chill. A tingly whoosh of air swept across my face, pricked my ears, and trickled along the back of my neck and down my spine. I had to wriggle a bit to let the feeling either shake off or settle in. I inhaled sharply. My ears took in big gulps of sound, swallowing every chant, prayer, and clap-clap until all activity grew muffled for a few moments. When my breath steadied and the sounds normalized, Tati Mimos fixed her unblinking eyes on mine and spoke again in a gravelly voice. This time, I understood every word. "I am the warrior from the Ogun line, here with a message for you," she began. "You have been chosen. Live in your truth." A shiver ran through me. Gripped by a wave of fogginess, my knees buckled and I fell to the floor. And just as suddenly, I saw the light. As in Thomas Edison's. It was the harsh ceiling light that had been switched on, snapping Tati Mimos and me back to reality. The ceiling fan switched on too, its whir snuffing out the prayer candles and the flame in the basin. "What's going on here?" shrieked my mom, her astonished face in stark contrast to the image of the serene, haloed lady on her St. Anne can tea. My wide-eyed father and my grandmother were right behind her. The next events unfolded more quickly than I could keep up with. Me clawing at the rug fibers in a feeble attempt to stand, my dad and grandma darting over to help me up, the clap-clapping women scurrying out the door, and my aunt and mom icily facing off with each other. "Mimos, how could you?" Mom shouted, glaring at her kid sister. As I got to my feet, I clowned. "No, no, Mom. That's actually the warrior. Igu, I think it was." My joke didn't land, which was okay, as long as it made my family see that I was unharmed and safe. Grandma Rose's arms were outstretched, inviting me into her embrace. I rested my head on her bosom like I was doing it for her benefit, not mine. "You have been chosen?" My mother echoed Tati Mimos's words. She turned to Grandma Rose. "Did you hear that, Mummy? They've cursed my baby."
"How do you make that leap to cursed?"
"Oh, right, because it's voodoo," Tati Mimos fired back. She snatched the basin from its perch, stormed over to a fancy laundry bag leaning against the wall, and shoved the basin in it. Next, my aunt grabbed all the cooled-down candles. Everything fit in that same bag. "Is that her voodoo travel kit?" I wondered.
"Because you got my daughter mixed up in something you had no right exposing her to," snapped Mom, stepping out of Daddy's path as he quietly set the coffee table back into its indentations on the rug.
"If I don't honor the spirits and pass what I know down to the next generation, who will?"
Tati Mimos asked. She looked to Grandma Rose for backup. I saw my grandmother pinch her face, working her trademark deep disappointment look she'd perfected during all those decades as a high school art teacher. She said nothing. My mom scoffed.
"You have no idea what you're talking about."
Tati Mimos didn't miss a beat.
"I know plenty, including that what I did tonight is really no different from you driving hours every year to pay respect to a Catholic saint."
Mom's eyes flashed.
"Fine, for you. Just leave my Cicely out of it. She is to take no part in your rituals, you hear me?"
I felt the tension in my body rise. This was not good. I could do anything at that moment. Belt out the Scooby-Doo theme song, draft a saints and spirits peace treaty, if I knew it would make them stop arguing. But Grandma Rose tightened her embrace around me and started to lead me away.
"All this influence, and you use it to be selfish,"
my mom spat at Tati Mimos.
"You will never babysit Cicely again."
It was the last thing I heard before Grandma Rose softly closed my bedroom door behind us. She kept calm as she tucked me under my covers.
"It's all over," she assured me.
The worry in my stomach told me different.
"Is it? Will they ever be friends again?" Grandma Rose tapped my nose with her wonderfully wrinkly finger.
You've fallen out with your friend before, haven't you? I remember.
I thought about my best friend, Renee. At our last playdate, Renee had packed up her sleepover bag in a huff because I'd asked her to take a break from telling me about the news. Renee wanted to be a journalist when she grew up and was the only 9-year-old I knew who actually read the paper. But we'd made up the next day. This fight between my mom and aunt felt different.
But Mommy and Tati Mimos are sister best friends.
Well, as long as I'm around, they will stay that way.
And after you're gone? I asked in a little voice. Grandma Rose smiled sadly.
I'll always be around.
Even after I'm gone, you can find me in your favorite song, in the laughter of my favorite students, or...
Grandma Rose took off her necklace and clasped it around my neck. In the glimmer of my favorite things. I touched the gold links around my neck.
Understood?
Asked my grandmother. Yes, I breathed. I closed my eyes when I heard Grandma Rose leave the room. I tried to return to the realm I was in before, the one with the shooting stars, but I was too weighed down by worries to travel the cosmos now. What had happened at the ceremony tonight? Was my mom right? Had I been cursed? I kept hearing my mom's other words play in my head.
You will never babysit Cicely again.
How could I reach for the stars when one of the biggest in the galaxy, Tati Mimos, had been declared off-limits to me? My universe wouldn't be the same without her.
Chapter 1. Present Day.
I must be cursed. Maybe it's just bad luck, but beginnings always seem to go wrong for me. And the way something kicks off determines how it lands, right?
Today, the Thursday before Labor Day, is my first day of sophomore year, and I'm running late. I rush through the doors of Christian Prep, weaving through the hallway mob like I'm swimming upstream. Last night, I did everything right. I set positive intentions while ironing and laying out my uniform, took a bath with the healing salts Tati Mimos posted about on her socials, and I still overslept. All that needs to happen now for me to truly be on brand is to get lost on the way to class. I speed snake my way through chatty black and brown students in white polos with starched collars, smooth khakis, pleated gray skirts, and maroon sweaters. Everyone's braids, twists, froes, locks, coils, curls, edges, or straight strands are first day fresh. Everyone has that prayed-over sheen to them. I breathe in a mix of scented lotion and that fresh-out-the-box school supplies smell. Things could be worse. On the first day of my freshman year, I got hit by a parked car. That's a word. As I stepped off a curb between two seemingly parked cars, the quiet hybrid crept back and bumped my leg. The car stopped as soon as I slapped my palm against its trunk, and it did no more than ashen up my skin. But still. And let's not relive my cringy first day of eighth grade. Long story, but it involved a crowded after-school meetup, a super clear glass wall, and my forehead. Conk! Finally, out of breath, I make it to my first period class, World Literature. It's only 10 seconds after the late bell.
Always one straggler in every bunch, the teacher, Sister Lucille, snarks dryly.
I ignore the muffled chuckles around me. Winded, I plop into the first empty desk I find. Why would a teacher give anyone a hard time for dragging a little this morning? Most of us have barely had time to adjust to this new and early start date. It's still August for Beyonce's sake. True, I have cousins in Atlanta who start school in damn near July, but this is Brooklyn. In Brooklyn, it's still very much summer. Every breathing West Indian around here knows that our version of Caribbean Carnival the much-anticipated event, also known as the West Indian Day Parade, or the Labor Day Parade, marks the official end of summer break. The parade is happening this coming Monday. It's tradition. And this year, the parade also falls on my birthday. That feels like a little bit of the good luck I need. Sister Lucille begins to take attendance. I raise my hand when she calls my name, then sneak a glance down at my phone in my lap. I know I'll have to stash it away before class starts for real, but I can't resist checking out my aunt's latest post. It's a selfie that shows off Mimos' stunning features. She's got her coils gorgeously pinned into those classic 1940s hair rolls. Tati Mimos and I have the same dark chestnut tresses, brown eyes, and heart-shaped brown face. But when I once tried to copy that same retro hairstyle, I looked like one of those pastoral sheep with spiral horns. I notice an altar set up behind my aunt. It's lined with tall prayer candles, dried flowers, and tiny framed photos of ancestors who are no longer with us. My eyes sting when they land on Grandma Rose's photo. My everything, Grandma Rose, passed away last year. The rest of my freshman year did not get much better after I got hit by that parked car. Grandma Rose not being here for my birthday feels unbearable. What will it be like not waking up on Monday to her rendition of Bon Anniversaire, the old-time French happy birthday song she'd learned from her own grandmother? My breathing quickens, and sweat pricks at my temples at the thought of not hearing Grandma Rose's painfully off-key vocals. She sounded like an electric guitar with strep throat, and it made my ears want to weep. I used to troll her about her singing, but now I just miss it. To keep from drowning in a swell of sadness, I laser focus on the caption underneath my aunt's photo. Want to know something sensational? Carnival is going to hit different this year. I feel a tingle of intrigue, grateful for the distraction. I wonder what my aunt's mystery caption means. The post already has thousands of likes. My aunt is a voodooista influencer. Though the voodoo she presents on her social media is more like a fusion of New Age rituals mixed with island dabbling. Tati Mimos is a Brooklyn-born and bred Haitian, like both my parents, so she takes creative license with her spirituality. She wears her beliefs on her ethically made sleeves, and her followers praise her for it. Some people follow her for her tarot card readings and aesthetically pleasing posts. Others like how she reps the culture, no filter. Or they just dig her because she's hella beautiful. I follow her because I don't get to see her that often in real life. Ever since the blowout fight they had when I was 9, the tension between my aunt and my mom has been a few city blocks thick. But at least we always had Grandma Rose, the bridge that kept Mom and Tati Mimos connected and together. Ever since my grandma passed, that bridge has been burned, and the rift between my aunt and mom had gotten even wider. I double-tap my aunt's post to like it, but instead I unmute the sound. Papasha's sensational thumps from my phone speakers. "Hey!" someone shouts. "Labor Day are coming!" someone else trumpets in proud patois. From the second the beat drops, the class is instantly hype. They can't even help it. Heads start bobbing and voices call out the lyrics. This time of year, it takes nothing to get people jumping up to jump-ups. A papash bop is especially welcome. Papash is an island brethren from Brooklyn, and in my opinion, the illest rapper today. Oh, and he's gorgeous. Listening to his music has been my escape lately. There's something about the notes in his voice that ring true. And all of Flatbush lost their minds when he released Sensational, a carnival-themed banger earlier this summer to rep Caribbean hoods like ours. It's expected to be the biggest song at carnival. But my DJ slip-up is causing a stir at the wrong time. "Where is that coming from?" demands Sister Lucille. Frantic, I tap my screen to silence the song, but that only makes the music stop and start again. I scroll up, but that triggers the sound on the next post, some sort of movie trailer.
Who played that music?
Sister Lucille asks, looking every bit like Harriet the Spy in a nun cap. She starts making her way down the aisle in her chunky orthopedic shoes. Oh no. I manage to close out of the app, then reach an arm back to slip my phone into the unzipped pocket of my bag. One person takes notice of my movements, the boy sitting across from me. Roll call refreshed my memory of his name. Kwame Hilliard. He watches me with interest, like he's piecing things together. A throat click sound that could either be a snort of laughter or a sneeze escapes him. I look over and his eyes meet mine like it's his gotcha moment. He could snitch. One thing I didn't enjoy about my honors classes freshman year was the competitiveness that made everything feel a little like the Hunger Games. But Kwame Hilliard is a new face in the honors group. I'd seen him in passing last year, a blink of his piled high fro bobbing down the halls, or a flash of his smile in the cafeteria line. But that's about it. I don't really know him, though I have noticed he's got a lot of friends. Now I'm noticing a few more things about him, like the fact that he's observant, which is a church usher's way of saying nosy. God bless you, I respond to his sneezy throat click, meeting his eyes as if daring him to tell on me. A slow smirk tugs one corner of his mouth. Thank you, he answers, signing this moment's contract to confirm that yes, he'll keep my secret. You're welcome, is my thank you to him. He nods, amused. Even though I'm finished with my phone isn't finished with me. Just as Sister Lucille walks by my desk, it buzzes like a rat-sized bee in my bag. I sit very still, my heart galloping. That's gotta be my bestie, Renee. She texts me with breaking news no matter when she comes across it, even in the middle of her Latin class. I hold my breath as Sister Lucille stops behind me. In my efforts to look as casual as possible, I come short of whistling a jaunty show tune. As soon as Sister Lucille turns to go, I reach back to switch off my phone. I can't chance any more slip-ups. The moment my fingers don't feel the familiar ridges of my Galaxy print case, I panic. Looking for this? Sister Lucille asks, my phone gleaming as she sways it side to side. Sister, sticky fingers? The former tween magician in me would almost be impressed by her sleight of hand, if I weren't mortified. And speaking of hands, mine are still frozen on my backpack because apparently I can't move and think of a good lie at the same time. I was just grabbing something. Sister Lucille looks down at my phone screen and reads Renee's text out loud. Yo, your aunt is a goddess. Did you see her post? What's that about? The entire class erupts in volcanic laughter, and my cheeks start burning like hot lava. Most kids don't know my aunt is the fame influencer, Mimos Benoit. If they knew anything about me, it's that my parents run the struggling Haitian takeout restaurant, Port-au-Princesse. And now, apparently, that I'm the object of Sister Lucille's comedy routine. Whew, now I want to see this post, Sister Lucille sighs, faux impressed. One of her hands is holding my phone and the other is fanning the air. The way she's performing, you'd think there's a none but laughs sign over a velvet rope outside the classroom and we all paid a cover charge to get in here. Chuckles break out again, and I note how little it takes for reasonable people to act like a stale laugh track. I glance sideways and see that Kwame is still watching me, with a hitch of his eyebrow. I boldly meet his watchful stare. Now the amusement, or relief? Quirking one corner of his mouth communicates something different. I am of some comfort to him. Maybe he thought class with honors nerds would be robotic. I'm not sure he expected there'd be any humans malfunctioning, and I can tell this relaxes him. In this moment, him and me, eye to eye, we are the reverse Adam and Eve, aware of our nakedness, but not hiding it from each other. We don't run for cover. We don't place a fig leaf over what lies exposed. His honor's class discomfort, my chaotic moment. Understanding this and seeing my faults welcomed relaxes me. For a minute, anyway.
I will hold on to your phone until the end of class, Ms. Destin,
Sister Lucille tells me sharply. She turns on her boomer heels and begins her slow creep to the front of the classroom.
Speaking of goddesses, my teacher continues as I slump in my seat, which Greek mythology goddess could be considered the patron saint of popularity? Anyone want to take a guess?
Kwame starts fidgeting like a Jeopardy contestant with a broken buzzer. He knows the answer, but he's scanning the room as if expecting someone else to respond. Why doesn't he just say it? I raise my eyebrows and give him a look like, speak up. Kwame's ink-black eyes shift to me and he mumbles,
theme,
under his breath, as if he's expecting me to share.
Not gonna happen. I'm trying to stay unseen right now.
Did somebody say theme? Questions Sister Lucille, glancing toward our corner of the classroom.
I thought I just heard the answer come from this area. No?
Kwame doesn't own up to it.
Must have been my imagination, she relents. But Feme is right. Known as the goddess of popularity, Feme would go viral pretty regularly if she were a real person in today's world.
I give Kwame a knowing look, which he acknowledges with a wink. I roll my eyes and look away, fighting back a smile. At least I can feel some of the awkwardness of being put on blast melt away. For the rest of the class, Sister Lucille has us read and discuss a passage in our Mythology Through the Ages book. When the bell rings and I stand up, she walks over and hands me my phone.
This isn't freshman year anymore, she says quietly. We're stepping things up. Phones off in my class.
Chastened, I nod and inch my way into the bottlenecking crowd heading out the door. In the hallway, friends separated during class reunite like matching pairs of socks after a tumble in the dryer. I feel a pang of sadness that Renee and I have totally opposite schedules this year that keep us from seeing each other during the day. Another bit of bad luck. But I'm happy that we'll be meeting up after school to go shopping for carnival outfits.
Sister Lucille may be getting old, but nothing wrong with her hearing.
It's Kwame, who is suddenly beside me. I meet the challenge that sparkles in his eyes.
She could hear your phone buzzing a mile away,
he adds.
How dare he bring that up?
Not as clearly as she heard your nerdy answer, I bite back.
When he looks around to make sure no one else heard me, I can't help but smirk. He nods.
Okay, I see how it's going to be.
Yo, Professor Kwame!
His friends call out, slapping his back as we merge into the hallway traffic.
Yo, he don't even look the same, another friend jokes. My dude, why is your fro like a whole inch shorter?
As they lead him down the corridor, Kwame manages to communicate one last thing to me. The slightest hint of a shoulder shrug that seems to sign off from the Kwame I met in class to another, more famous Kwame.
I get it.
Mind swirling, I head toward my second period class, in the wrong direction, of course.
I spin my behind around to go the right way and tell myself this flustered feeling is because sophomore year is off to a rocky start. It has nothing at all to do with Kwame Hilliard.
Chapter 2.
You know Sister Lucille was just messing with you.
Renee says, and deftly sucks her teeth as we step outside school.
And nobody's thinking about your cafeteria mustard spill. Trust. If you ask me, that stain looks kind of cute. Like a C monogram.
I look down at the splotch of yellow on my white polo shirt, courtesy of a slip-up I had with the mustard squeeze bottle at lunch. I shake my head.
Not seeing it, but okay.
As my best friend and I walk down the street, I can't shake the feeling that I really might be cursed. Logically, I know a bad first day of school doesn't mean I'm in for a bad year. So why is doubt shredding that argument like its street name is Edward Scissorhands? I guess I'll just have to see which way this year will go. The thought hits me as Renee and I are literally standing at a crossroads. This is the junction, the huge intersection in our neighborhood where island culture blooms and coils itself around everything. Here you'll find plentiful plantains at the bodega and peppery patois on every tongue. It's kind of like the Times Square at Flatbush, a destination throbbing with businesses of all kinds, big box, mom and pop, street vendors, plus the people they attract, most of them speaking in English or French-based Creole. We longtime locals know these streets so well, we can recognize every ancient blot of sidewalk chewing gum. Newcomers, though, love that the junction is accessible to Manhattan, thanks to the train line right at the cross streets of Nostrand and Flatbush Avenues. Renee and I expertly outpace the stampede of the subway commuters emerging from below, their eyes squinting in the light. I can almost sense their inner compasses recalibrating as they orient themselves to life above ground. It's somehow on me to make sure Renee doesn't collide with anyone. The girl insists on keeping her brown eyes locked on her phone as she walks. She's afraid to miss any piece of potential news. "Gangway," I warn, but all she does is laugh at my old-timey slang that I picked up watching TV classics with Grandma Rose. We join a small crowd of people at the corner waiting for the light, and I look around. It's one thing to be alive in these Brooklyn streets, but Brooklyn streets during carnival season are another dimension entirely. It's a wonder the curbside vendors have any island nation flags left. Every car that drives past has their homeland flag flapping hello. Having lived here our whole lives, Renee and I recognize each one we spot. Guyana, St. Kitts and Nevis, Jamaica, Barbados, Haiti, Trinidad and Tobago, St. Vincent and the Grenadines, Bahamas, St. Lucia, Panama, Antigua, Grenada, Dominica, Montserrat, Turks and Caicos, Suriname, Belize, Puerto Rico, the Dominican Republic, Cuba, the Cayman Islands, all the Virgin Islands. Everyone is here to represent. Renee looks up from her phone to take in my still tense expression. She reaches up to my shoulder and affectionately tugs one of my twists.
"You good?" she rasps.
Renee has the best voice, husky and strong. Even though she's petite, a full head and a half shorter than me, her voice is tall enough to dunk on any baller at Barclays Center. "I am," I say, trying to shake off my worry cloud.
"Promise?"
Renee says. "Promise," I say. She lifts her pinky and I hook mine around hers, sealing the "we got this" pact we've perfected ever since the fourth grade, when we mutually agreed to do life as besties. My bony brown pinky, entwined with her plump brown one, is familiar as ever. As we cross the street, Renee glances back at her phone and gasps.
"Okay, ready for this?"
she asks me. Informing people is Renee's thing. It drives her, and I admire her whole journalistic heart. She works hard constantly updating her heinous crime breaking news Twitter account at Is It One of Us. It's gaining in popularity as more Black folks follow her to find out whether or not a suspect behind a viral incident is Black. People appreciate it for the sweet relief or the shared embarrassment space it offers. "What is it?" I ask, bracing myself for more potentially bad news. But Renee is smiling. She pulls me over to stand in the cool shade below the awning of West Indian Village Accounting, LLC. She switches her bag to the opposite shoulder and smooths her already slicked down side ponytail with one hand.
"You'll never guess," she begins.
I'm reminded of how much Grandma Rose loved my breaking news Renee impersonations, and a quick sorrow tugs at my heart. I would run through all of Renee's story setups from "Did you hear?" to "You'll never guess," when Renee would skip the suspense
It was only with a terse girl, sis, and my personal preference, yo. In those moments, Grandma Rose marveled at how much I moved and even sounded like Renee.
How do you do that?
She'd ask, laughing.
It's like you really jumped right into Renee's spirit and started wearing it around.
Grandma Rose's comment stayed with me. I got chills once when I read that the Latin root words in impersonate are into and a person, which to me sounds real shapeshifty. Are we dipping into another person's essence on some level when we impersonate them so well? Renee gives my arm a squeeze.
Cicely, you with me?
I blink away my memories and smile.
The suspense is killing me, girl. Out with it, I shout playfully.
Renee beams under the rays of my full attention.
You wouldn't believe, she says. Papash is performing at the parade.
She can barely get out the last few words before I start jumping up and down.
Oh my God, no way, I screech.
Wait, how do you know? Are you sure?
Renee has already anticipated this question because she's holding out her screen to me. I sigh at the photo of silky-skinned Papash on a rooftop holding out his arms as if he's giving Brooklyn a hug. The boy looks exquisite in his simple white tee and jeans that show off his sculpted, rice-and-peas-fed physique. But Papash is more than a beautiful face, frontin' a dope beat. He's a 19-year-old peacemaker. The only thing more amazing than his message of unity and love is his voice. I'm convinced his vocals are on some healing frequency because I feel lighter after hearing him. After Grandma Rose's funeral, I listened to his studio album and live performances nonstop on Spotify. It helped.
He just posted the news on his IG, Renee says, pointing to the caption. He says that before his performance, he'll be a guest on a podcast that's recording live at the parade. And yo, a local Haitian American influencer is going to interview him.
My heart jumps for a second. A local Haitian American influencer? I think of my aunt and her cryptic post with the Papash music from this morning. Was that meant to be a hint? Could it be?
Are you thinking what I'm thinking?
Renee asks, her eyes sparkling.
I am, but I don't want to get my hopes up.
The host is probably a historian, I say, or a DJ or costume designer.
Maybe, Renee says, but Mimos has over 200,000 followers. Celebrities are starting to consult her, and her sponsors are only getting bigger.
Should I call her to find out? I ask, unsure. Or maybe text?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.